I got a repeat from the young gentleman. Thank you for coming out to our program this evening. Welcome to the Muscarella Museum of Art. And I want to greet you on behalf of our staff. A number of people are here, and our assistant director, Dr. John Spike, is here. And I want to say it might be a first for us this evening at the Muscarella Museum of Art that our featured speaker is a biological anthropologist. We're gathered this evening for our third and final lecture in our series to commemorate the 50th anniversary of African Americans in residence on this campus. And I want to note that there will be a reception following the talk, sponsored by Sonobank, and we thank them for that. When the talk is over and the questions are over, just wait for the staff. We'll put the chairs away and then we'll start the reception, so just give us a moment. I want to say that our speaker was reluctant to come to do this and really came as a favor to me. And he said, you know, I'm not really ready to talk about art. But I said, oh, but you do have something to say about remembering and commemoration. And he actually knows Fred Eversley personally, who's at the exhibit upstairs, so I also use that as a hook. But I have to say, our speaker is really well-versed in museums. He knows about museums. He's currently a member of the Scholarly Advisory Committee of the Smithsonian's new National Museum of African American History and Culture on the Mall. Dr. Blakey has consulted on numerous museum exhibitions, including the American Anthropological Association's very important exhibit titled Race, Are We So Different? And the Visitor Center at the African Burial Ground National Monument in New York City. I think that's pretty museum heavy. Thus, it's fitting that we are joined by Dr. Michael Blakey tonight. He is a National Endowment for the Humanities Professor at William & Mary in the Department of Anthropology and American Studies, and he is both the founder and director of the Institute for Historical Biology. Professor Blakey received his BA from Howard University, had his MA and PhD from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. And I'm adding, he's an accomplished sailor also. His professional accomplishments are numerous. At Howard University, he was the curator of the William Montague Cobb Human Skeletal Collection. He's held visiting positions at Spelman College, Universidad de Roma, the Smithsonian Institution, Brown Institution, and Columbia University. But importantly, Dr. Blakey served as the director of the New York African Burial Ground Project in Manhattan, and without a doubt, one of the most important archaeological projects in the United States in the 21st century as well. The research reports, multiple volumes from the years of work on the project, address much more than the analysis of skeletal remains. The group of eminent scholars assembled by Dr. Blakey to contribute to the research have demonstrated the impact of slavery written in bones of the enslaved community in colonial New York by looking at things such as stress due to labor, nutrition, and DNA analysis. In 26, the ABG, the African Burial Ground, was designated a national monument. Dr. Blakey has continued his work at the intersection of human biology, culture, preservation, and politics. He's currently at work on the Remembering Slavery, Resistance, and Freedom Project. As a scholar, he's led the way in both research and community engagement, centering on remembrance. I'm honored to call him my colleague and friend, and tonight I welcome him as our guest speaker.
Thank you, Professor Randy Langholz. It's always
Turn up the volume.
How's that? Is that better?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. pleasure to be here at the Muscle Rally and to commemorate an important year, the 50th anniversary of the first three black students, African American women, to attend the College of William Mary and with the residents here, Janet Brown Strapper, Kara Healy, and Lynn Riley. I'm reminded, as I think about 50 years, for some reason, an experience I had some time ago comes to mind. When I was sitting, walked to a bench on the yard of my alma mater, sat down, and an older gentleman, also an alumnus, came by and said, he started a conversation by saying, you know, I said, I like the way you walk. He said, it's purposeful. And I guess it's true. In those days, I was moving kind of fast. And he had my attention. And he said, you know, our alma mater that we love to, that we have a loving relationship with that student. He says, you know, this is the only play institution I know that gets to the 50-yard line and stops to have a celebration. And that didn't resonate with me. So, it says something also about, especially, I think, celebrating the firsts. In a way, that celebration represents so much of what has not been as it does represent the accomplishment. Celebration of the beginning. Beginnings are important. But if one knows the College of William Mary, issues of diversity that exist today, we have a very long way to go. There's another example that comes to mind. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
You can't hear me in the back.
No. You have to speak into the microphone.
Well, this is about as close as I think I should get. So I don't know if somebody else can do anything. Can you hear me now? Okay. So at the donors opening of the new National Museum of African American History and Culture, another celebration, great museum that's broken records in just about every way. Masses of people in line for tickets for over a year now. It's a brilliant green. Celebration, critical and otherwise, of the African American experience. There on the Mall, it took 100 years for it to go from its first proposal to installation. And so here we were at one of the two first openings for donors of material. And as we're feeling, you know, this success, getting to in the early down the first floor, as you get in that history that starts with the slave trade, my friend and I saw a middle-aged white woman turn and walk briskly through the exhibition, saying as though others should hear it, "When will this ever end?" Followed by a sheepish husband, I think. And I understand that there are many more like her in silence. So, the celebration is important to reinforce our understanding of what has been done, important to inspire us as well to move forward. Because So the New York African Burial Ground. Is an 18th century archaeological site and cemetery in Lower Manhattan. It, and here you see it in the early years when it was first encountered during a federal General Services Administration construction project to build a 36-story office tower. And as the law requires, archaeological work needs to be done ahead of the construction to mitigate the destructive effects on historical resources. And that was all underway. And however, there were a number of problems and, that I'll just touch on the more important ones. Ultimately, however, I would say this became one of the most influential archaeological projects of the turn of the 21st century. We are preparing now symposia, two of them, one in executive session at the American Anthropological Association meetings coming up in later this month, called Beyond the African Burial Ground. These follow three sessions held last year at the World Archaeological Congress in Kyoto, Japan, where in both cases, people from around the country, around the world, who are doing work related, influenced in some way by the kind of public engagement and the questions that the community provided us with, like the approach, approaches that we made on this project now 25 years ago or so. But it began with struggle. Much of the, let me say that we determined that this cemetery that's just across from City Hall, down not far from the Brooklyn Bridge, on Broadway and Duane Streets, had originally been 5.5 acres and contained 15,000 human remains of Africans who had lived and died in New York, beginning perhaps sometime in the late 1600s, certainly no earlier than 1650, no later than the 1690s, until 1794. And we have divided that into the archaeologists among us into four different temporal phases. One of the, perhaps the basic surprise about this site is that it was there at all. We have in our history, and probably still, the idea that Africans didn't live in the Northeast or New England, or certainly that slavery was not there. We have an emancipatory narrative that really follows the Civil War, that defines the North as that place of freedom, in contrast to a now defeated South, as part of the characterization of the purpose of the war. Ultimately about freedom that initially was about the Union, although a culture worker once said about his southern colleagues, southern friends in Virginia, that they say it was about states' rights, but the only states' right they were willing to fight over was slavery. So that thing evolved in an interesting way, but in the end, the North characterized itself with this emancipatory narrative, and we have been left with it, that in a sense, well, we're about to go into Thanksgiving, aren't we? Where the origin of the nation was here in Jamestown. If you look at it closely, it's kind of hard to valorize incompetence, laziness, and greed, and slavery, which is much of what that story is about. instead we have something about Salem, Plymouth, religious freedom. These are all ideas that are generated on interpretations of history. And it was Lincoln who influenced the creation of a national Thanksgiving holiday. Again, it's part of this emancipatory narrative about the North, which represents then also the nation. There was slavery in all 13 colonies. 20% of New York's city's population was African at the time of the War of Independence. Ira Berlin argues that 50% of its labor force was African. Thinking of Thomas Jefferson's argument in the 18th century, or his assertion in his Notes on the State of Virginia, in this Manners chapter, which is a wonderful chapter, just 2 pages, in which he says, rarely has he seen a slaveholder who was involved in any labor. So this is a function of warm places. He basically says, Virginia is hot. If you can get out of work, you will. And all these slaveholders were in a position of not working, certainly with their hands. You know, he was a little different, but I don't know quite how much so. So the labor in New York, from the port to the mines in that county, to the ferries, everything involved enslaved African labor, as it did as a majority population in Williamsburg. And in addition to being involved in the building, they built Broadway, they pulled down all the trees, and leveled the road and so forth. But in addition to, and they were also involved in growing grain in Long Island and parts of New York. It's also being produced for sale to the West Indies, where the real slavery money machine was, provisioning those people. So, and New York was very much involved in that trade. So there were slaves there, they were trading in enslaved people, and they were involved in the economy of slavery in the place where slavery was most intensive in the Caribbean, as it would become also in places like Virginia. So given that we were all socialized in this idea that slavery was an institution of the South, this was a kind of surprise. Yet, African Americans have a long, and in other diasporic people, Haitians are a good example, a long history, an intellectual tradition of critical historiography. It certainly goes, and anthropology, one includes sort of the ethnological work of people like Equiano, who wrote against the slave trade at the turn of the 18th century, or Frederick Douglass, who was engaged in work on an ethnological response to the first craniometricians, the biological determinists, people in my field, as they began in the U.S., naturalizing slavery, creating ideas that justified slavery as a natural inequality, not an inequity. And African Americans throughout have written about this Euro-American historiography, Euro-American science that confronted it at the time. And Turner of Men in Haiti confronted the French Academy of Anthropological Society, all actually with very forward-thinking ideas. Some have argued that their ideas were ahead of those ideas of the mainstream academy, that were locked within the assumptions of white supremacy. You couldn't seem to find their way out, so they kept reproducing nonsense, essentially, for 100 years, while these others, critical of it, could see Frederick Douglass begins the nature-nurture debate, because he argues the nurture side, that he says people are determined by their circumstances, while Samuel Wharton measures skulls and says, well, they're not determined by their skull size. That begins with, in the year of the publication of Types of Mankind, 1854, with Frederick Douglass's response to it. He begins the nature-nurture debate in the U.S. So, and with the, throughout that, you know, there's, we get Black History Month from an early African-American historical society, that Carter G. Woodson headed. Started out as Black History Week, as they created another historical, another history to obviously complicate the one they found. So, and in New York, there were many African Americans who were aware of the continuing tradition of critical thought. And so that this discovery, this surprise, was fit within an understanding of the expected surprise. Of course that history was omitted. Of course the history was distorted. This is what we see over and over and over again. So there was a kind of celebration of the discovery. Some all that they were there in such numbers, and that slavery was there. But I think this kind of surprise for African Americans is quite different than the kind of surprise for Euro Americans. And it was all an inspiration of various kinds to each. This is the site map from the burial ground. 419 human remains were ultimately excavated and studied in our labs. The Cobb Laboratory at Howard University was the main laboratory for skeletal biology, paleopathology, working with skeletons. There were 25 people working in that lab every day for 3 or 4 years. There were 8 other institutions and laboratories involved in archaeology. Most of the history was done at Howard. I'd estimate about 200 students and technicians, 35 PhDs. It's a $6 million project. This was a fairly big science for my field. That's just the analysis, the excavation also cost more. But I became director of the project. At the end of excavation, but here you see all the coffins. This is also the largest non-native colonial skeletal population available for study. So there's no English, Dutch, population. This population provides a biological data for non-indigenous people in the Americas so far. And it's large enough to represent about 3% of the living population of Africans in New York. So that means you can also extrapolate to real conditions. Very often in bioarchaeology, we're dealing with very small samples, 9 individuals, maybe 30. I worked at the Smithsonian with Leslie Rankin-Hill on what was previously the largest African-American population that we saw, we made sure it was buried in Philadelphia. It's the first African Baptist church.
church. That was 140 individuals. So Dr. Reagan-Hill and I went to this project with that experience. But most of the time, you've got, unfortunately, my colleagues, and at one time I worked with something, one of the Italians on the Merowitic site, which was a Sufi site, different phases. Maybe we had 30 individuals representing 1,000 years. You know, this is more a game than science. But at this point, with this kind of sample, it becomes real science.
Right.
So, in the 18th century, the cemetery meant something. I was asked to present a briefing speech, essentially, to a subcommittee of the Human Rights Commission at the United Nations as a result of this site sometime in the mid-1990s. And it, because community members were human rights activists brought me there, it was willing to, as you will see, describe our process. We follow the community. The community are our clients, try to be of service to them with our particular skills. And so I had to think about what am I doing talking to the Human Rights Commission? What does this cemetery have to do with human rights? And so that got me started towards an understanding that continues to grow for me. That has led to ideas. I guess I follow one of my mentors, W. Montague Cobb, who was the first African-American physical anthropologist. He had 1,100 publications, all kinds of awards. Had the pen that LBJ used to sign Medicare into, you know, being, this is the kind of person. And he, as he got older, he became very philosophical, and he would, there's a publication in which he describes Homo sapiens and Homo sanguinis. So he uses specific names as ways of talking about something. And so I guess I prematurely slipped into that and have begun to write about human beings as Homo reminiscens. And one of my colleagues here in the classics helped me work out as a participle, like sapiens. And so this is humans, or man, we used to say, the memorializer. The one who memorializes his or her dead. This seems very appropriate because archaic Homo sapiens do that. You know, as I thought about the Human Rights Commission, I said, well, what do I say about what it means to be human in a final exam? At that time, I was teaching Introduction to Physical Anthropology. So you go through all the hominid or hominin stuff. You know, they walk on two legs, they use technology, they share food. These are subsequent species. They use fire, Pithecanthropus or Homo erectus. The earliest Homo sapiens buries its dead. No other species does this, to my knowledge. And we all have some sort of funerary treatment. We are defined as a species by this kind of behavior. We've got little markers all over the world. Big ones, little ones, you know, long ones, short ones. What kind of animal is that? And at the same time, I think, you know, early on, and well, there's some debates about this. It appears that there's food is put in these burials, or flowers, as though the dead can use these things. Most of the living were celebrating something with these things. But there may be an idea that in one way or another, I'm agnostic, so I would say, whether, you know, as a spirit or as a memory, the dead live on. And, you know, we're food sharing species. This is how our economies develop. And in a way, the dead remain part of the family with libations and other ways in which we share with ancestors, keep them in the social reciprocity. So, cemeteries are partly how we recognize our humanity. And I would say, maybe this one. Yeah. So this might be an example. But we also have Homo sapiens. I don't know if we are wise at all, but we're certainly curious. We have many characteristics. And so sapiens and reminiscence come into conflict. In this case, grave robbing for Columbia Medical School in 1788 and before, particularly of poor white and the African burial ground, which was a separate cemetery for Africans, took place. There are many stories about the last straw that led to a riot of hundreds of people in the street and burnings of buildings and so on. That's Homo reminiscens. That this means something to people. At any rate, free blacks wrote at that time, just before the riots broke out, that what they called doctors of physic were warned to stop their grave robbing. And especially, they said, in the night. So that's a time when things can happen to you. But they didn't listen, and it went on. Finally, they closed the cemetery not long after these riots. And then I have said near Dinkins at the African Burial Ground in the 1990s. I don't think the GSA was really Homo sapiens. I think they were curious about much of anything. They wanted to build their building. They wanted to build it on time and with a budget they could be proud of. They missed those opportunities, partly because they were embroiled in trying to take shortcuts around legal requirements that the community be satisfied with what they are doing. I guess a long story short would be that the thousands of people, African Americans primarily, protested, held prayer vigils, candlelight vigils. In 1992 especially, late 1991 as well. The site was really first publicized in October of 1991. Calling for a halt to construction. We're talking about here one of the earliest and largest cemeteries, monuments, the African American people, of the American people for that matter. So there was an extraordinary amount of political activity on the part of the mayor's office, on the part of Congress. In time, as the GSA kept trying to push forward, and a number of the devious ways that are reminiscent of many other things that happened, particularly in the relationship between African Americans and white power, which is essentially what they would represent. Who would it, or, you know, the whiteness was there. You can think of it in other fundamental ways as having to do with developers, but there was a certain disregard that's best understood in terms of the racial dynamics involved as well, or what those people wanted to do. Somebody said, this was a black architect in New York, said, why do I think if they had found some dinosaurs here, we'd have gotten a better response? But Mayor Dinkins was in office. Gus Savage, at that time, a lame duck legislator from Chicago, chaired the committee that oversaw all of the GSA's funds. And a member of the Congressional Black Caucus held a field hearing, a hearing in D.C. I was at both, testifying in the D.C. one, and brought it all to a halt. I would just say that the initial archaeologists were low bid. This is how the survey was done. Really didn't know much about African American, much African American, much less African archaeology, which is what you need to know to deal with a site of people who were largely Africans. And I had done African American archaeology, studied African archaeology, actually, because I did some bioarchaeology here, but I also knew who to hire. That's my integrative project, by hiring all the kinds of specializations that are needed. I became specialization cop, so it kept people from going into other people's domains. That's quite a challenge. But they were really way over their heads in a lot of ways. And so the number of agencies brought me in, and I created a project that I described, at least in numbers, but the qualities would involve those individuals who I knew were experts in West African and West Central African, Caribbean and Northeastern archaeology, history, and biology. And this will make a difference, because they will have eyes to see and understand what it is they're looking at in the ground. Whereas if you have none of that training, you're looking at, as we'll see, a heart shape is an important artifact that looked like, for people who have no understanding of any African heart shapes, it looked like they're from them, their point of view, the kind of heart shape we all think of as representing love, you know, on a coffin lid. But bringing in specialists who knew the cultural context that the people buried there were raised within can see, have eyes to see the greater diversity that brings to the project and brings to the interpretation of those people a humanity. And in fact, you know, some cultural resource management projects, and we were sort of an academic CRM blend, are required to really talk about the block, the city block, or the immediate area of the cemetery. And so we would have, therefore, have had a discussion about enslavement and burial. But because of the process I'm about to describe to you, we were able to use an African diasporic framework with these people coming from, who studied throughout those regions where people, where the most buried in the burial ground were born and raised and moved around, so that we could describe their lives. We could interpret them as human beings, not just as slaves and as people buried there, but as people who had human cultural imagination and experiences affecting their health, everything else, all along the way. They did not born and raised as that object. And to do that, you need a diasporic breadth. So at any rate, the project, the construction was stopped, and ultimately only half the building would be built. The other half of the building was reserved for a monument. And in the building that was built, there would be a visitor center. So, understand that the GSA first insisted that they would put a plaque on the wall of their building. And now what we have is a U.S. National Monument, a visitor center, and so on. That's what the public was able to do. And we worked for them. My team submitted our proposals to the descendant community, we called them. This was also in a time when Native people in the U.S. and elsewhere were struggling for the return of their remains. The Smithsonian was under, I guess, it just succeeded in 1990 with the Native American Graves Protection and Repatriation Act. I was very much involved in those discussions in the 80s. Where Native people had the right to get, have all, it is a whole office at the Smithsonian that does nothing but return remains to Native people, help them to identify who they go to, right? Is it Homo? Reminiscence. So, I had bought fully into that idea. People have a right to determine the disposition of their ancestral remains. And it's a sort of familial. Right? My family, my neighbors will not have anything to do with determining how I bury my mother. This is, as I said, and I think maybe it's useful to say that I'm agnostic, although I might, as I said, once try to give my son some room to where I might be a secular Christian, because I grew up that way and I know a lot about it, and you know, the golden rule, who can question that? But this is a human business. It may be it's about all religion and none. It is burial of the dead is the first archaeologically demonstrable, maybe there's some more stuff I haven't seen lately, but essentially the first symbolic communication. It's about being human. I have colleagues who said would want to have control of their remains. Smithsonian kept one very much in mind. Who argue that these Indians are imposing their religious values on us. I think I'll get to some of that work actually if I have time. They're imposing the fact that they're human beings on us. And that's something that we are ethically bound, I think, to respect. So my team are also people I think who have been working with some of these issues, and we understand that we have a right to, that the communities have a right to determine the disposition of their remains. However, we are anthropologists and historians, and we have something to give. I got into this because I thought I had something, would have something to give. And sometimes we can write work of recreating a history where the written documentation doesn't exist, because we look at the artifacts and we look at, there are no artifacts. You know, as one of my American Studies graduate students once said, when he took my course, he was a literary lit crit guy, he said, oh, so you read the skeleton as text? Yes, that's close enough. And so we have those skills. So the point is, and I began this actually with the Pawnee, and I won't go into that story, but that was where it began with Native American Rights Fund in 89, before NAGPRA, trying to work this out. So we, our ethical client, are the descendant, is the descendant community. And these are the people who are affected by what we do, ethically, possibly hurt by desecration. We are bound to do no harm. It's not the bones, it's the people who are living. And so, and they are possibly, you know, have some at least community lineage, if not a biological one, to these ancestors. And so they are kind of surrogate family. And so those African Americans showed up, and they were welcomed all over this site. They had control by the time, shortly after I got there. They were getting it under control when I showed up. And so we began a process in which we shared proposals with them and asked them for the questions they were interested in having answered. And through that process of hearings downtown in Harlem and elsewhere, we developed a 160-page research design with questions that are better than the questions that my colleagues and I have toyed with in the American Journal of Physical Anthropology. Good questions. They wanted, and they are questions that were appropriate to that community. They wanted to know the origins of these first African Americans. And that's a problem, because slavery involved attempts to segment African Americans from their humanity, much less their origins. And some of that continued on, or quite may still be at play, to remove family names, remove language, remove all those things that would make it clear that these were human beings, so that they could be, as part of the regulation of slavery and the attempt to convert them into property, which was absolutely untenable. Sterling Stuckey says, African Americans freed themselves, and you can see that just by being what they were. The Union Army didn't free African Americans. African Americans had been able to accept slavery as though they were cattle. I would be your slave right now. But they struggled against it at all times, because they were human beings. It was absolutely untenable. You could call me Blakey, but that name would simply become appropriated. Now people say in Orange County, Virginia, well, some guy, Blakey, white Blakey, who came by and met this old guy in the woods and was looking for the old plantation site, the ruin, met the old guy. Guy Blakey was now from the West Coast. And the old guy looks at him and says, "Blakey, you're not a Blakey. Blakey's is black." So people will. Origins. And so there was a lot of DNA and other stuff we used, cultural information. We were not privileging the biological data for the cultural, probably because to some extent, I've done a lot of work on the sort of history and philosophy of science, and I know DNA lies just as quickly as art. It's all lines of evidence. It's all subjective. It's all about probabilities. So we're looking at different lines of evidence, just have a kind of conversation of evidence and come out with hopefully the most plausible answers. If you think DNA is a magic bullet, got some Kool-Aid to sell. So we are looking at all these kinds of things. Origins, physical quality of life. What were the conditions during their enslavement? And we can tell a lot about that from the skeleton. Transition. How did they what biological and cultural things changed that would make them African American? And then finally, resistance. What were their modes of resistance? Because this is truly a human characteristic, and one often neglected in this year. I'll just tell you just a bit about the Remembering Project, and went around the state asking people questions about the interpretation of slavery, and saw that in public schools, one of the things that they complained about African Americans is that resistance was omitted or presented as pathology, as in Nat Turner. Pathology. So once you see it at Columbia Williamsburg, one of the reasons African Americans don't show up in New York's history said, as soon as African Americans show up in New York's history, you ask what were they doing there? And the next answer is they were enslaved. And that changes the history of whites in New York, because now they're slaveholders. And if anywhere in the slaveholding world you have evidence, as there is, from poisonings to work slowdowns to armed rebellions to, of constant resistance, you have to ask, what were they resisting? We thought they were, you know, we were taking care of them. They were, you know, our family. They were, none of that is true. And so, and the brutality, absolute, utter brutality of trying to manage human beings as though they're property, constant whipping and various tortures, represents Ural America. The founding fathers, as I suggested, were involved in the management of slavery. The people who built the buildings, brick, made every brick, grew the tobacco that paid for the College of William and Mary, were Africans. So resistance is something that, you know, becomes an important element to remove and they or retain in the narrative. And so those were the four questions. The business client is the GSA. We owe them in contract to them. There's certain deliverables that they have a right to. But if they start to contradict what we've agreed with the ethical client is first. We have a project right now in Bethesda, Maryland, where we're still consulting with the community, but we've stepped aside because Montgomery County is trying to have us violate their interests. And when the community gets that thing under control, they'll be there if they want us. But we're not going to help. The editor of the New York Times, African American, used to say, they'd like to get black people would sit on people. We're not going to sit on anybody for anybody else. Right. And so with this sort of process, we develop a relationship with this community as we have with others, and then with the profession. So we have these hearings, we're looking at the questions, we're developing research design, and they may say something like, we don't like the use of the term slave. Well, we don't like the idea that you're talking about slavery in Africa. There was no slavery in Africa. And here is perhaps where the fact that, I should say, we were the most ethnically diverse archaeological project ever, which I think is often the way African Americans do things for practical and ideological reasons. But it was led primarily by African Americans. There are others in leadership as well. And in the end, we have produced the most sophisticated bioarchaeological report in 2,500 pages yet. But it also meant that when we were in these meetings, we understood some things that were said in particular ways, like there was no slavery in Africa. We understood that the idea of slavery being in Africa is part of the narrative of Africans caused slavery to come into existence. Now, Joseph Enikori, who's a historian who we brought on, understands the diversity of servitude in Africa. There are many different kinds of servitude, some of which are confused with slavery. And the kind of household slavery in Africa is more like the slavery among ancient Greeks, or biblical slavery. Chattel slavery in the Americas, where someone becomes property and denied all human rights, is a particularly brutal form of slavery on its own. But Enikori said, well, here, I'll tell you, if I offer $10,000 for a head, for a human head, and put it on my stoop tomorrow, heads will start coming. For every head, $10,000. That is the European and Euro-American role in slavery. They paid for it, they generated it. But, obviously, there were leading houses in various African countries that participated in it, and they became embroiled in it. So, our thing was to say, no, we will talk about slavery in Africa, but we understand that there's this narrative we have to be careful of, in which it's basically Euro-America attributing their moral failure to other people. In Virginia, I see this is amazing to me. I'm from D.C., though, as I said, ancestors here. That there are black people who are ashamed of slavery. And I think partly because of what they haven't been taught about Africa, slavery. Maybe it's this narrative. And there are some things about it that are certainly dehumanizing. But the only people who should be ashamed of slavery are Euro-Americans. Why would you be ashamed of having this brutal system imposed on your ancestors, and your ancestors prevailed? So, we talked about this as a complex issue. We will take care of looking at, but we will refer to slavery in Africa as we see it. They could have said, no study. And we would have accepted that what they want is another practitioner. Who is the usual practitioner for cemeteries? A religious practitioner. They have every right to immediately bury. But if they wanted us to be involved, we work with evidence. And so that's what we said. We're going to work with evidence, but we understand your concern. We hired Joseph Indicori, and so forth. So that's our relationship to the profession. Language change in the course of this. The term enslaved African has become customary now. It didn't roll off the tongue so well initially. I was beaten up enough times by community hearings by using the term slave that became, you know, very natural. Now editors all over the place, and especially at historic sites, use enslaved African by preference, because they were not, this community says, they were not these, they were not defined by their job title, if you were. Europeans defined them as slaves. They were, as one woman said, they were people with cultures all their own. How did they think of each other and talk to each other? Well, ultimately we find out once emancipation comes, we see the establishment of the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church. They're referring to themselves as Africans. John Zia, who was an itinerant preacher in 1810, writes an interesting narrative of life as an enslaved person brought from what is now Nigeria as a child and enslaved there. And he says, I am the African preacher, I'm not an American. So the sensibility of the community was right even before finding all of these, this confirmation that it would not be called the Negro's burial ground, but the African burial ground. They were a people enslaved actively. They were not nominally slaves. You know, we know they were enslaved. But there's a difference. So, you know, theory, UNESCO. I won't spend much time with this, but I do want to mention, I said there was sort of the antithesis of what we do. It was a very exciting project at the Smithsonian and elsewhere, around the discovery of a 9,000 plus year old skeleton in Washington State, and this was right after the NAGPRA legislation gave Native people the right to reburial. Smithsonian was very much in opposition to that right, but they lost. This guy from Washington State, the skeleton, these are two of the interpretive reconstructions. This is art, not science, but okay, maybe somewhere in there. And they said, well, you know, this guy's supposed to look like, looks like Patrick Stewart. So the idea first, they did not know the date, and he had a long head. He said, well, the forensics guy said, well, it's probably Caucasian. It's a white guy that maybe was killed, you know, within the last 100 years. Then they found the date, and they were stuck on that, and they were really excited that here was a Caucasian, not a Caucasian, a Caucasoid, something maybe like the Ainu of Japan, who were, have some features they compare with Caucasians, but they're actually not Caucasians, they're Caucasoid, and not Indian. And long story short, why not Indian? Because Sylvie Mutala had a right to have him buried. And these colleagues, like Doug Owsley, in the 80s was on the other side of the table with these guys on a regular basis. The Indians were on the... They were going to have control of skeletal remains for their purposes. They would think of them as ideal sort of scientific purposes, serving everyone. But here's an interesting look at the scientific values involved. So as forensic anthropologists, we use race a lot. We have important and serious critiques of the race concept. I don't use it. There are more precise ways of understanding human identity and more realistic ones. But for the sake of the police and the courts, for instance, folks, they ask age, sex, race, and so forth, and so they kind of stuck with race. So, they're using racial analysis, and they identify this person as Caucasoid. Even the arrow projectile point in his hip is now interpreted as evidence of hostility between this group and other native groups, as opposed to evidence of his time and space and participation in those cultures. They took him out of time and space by defining him racially as a Caucasoid or some kind of archaic Eurasian, which is what he is. And so the imagination with New York Times articles that I just saw people imagining that he was like commuting to Surrey or Sussex or something. What? First Americans were white people. Who would have thought? They milked that thing for 25 years. They had a big book out of it. The native people said, well, he's buried there. He must be from near there. Let me tell you the scientific hypothesis. Where do native people in the Americas come from, you think? Siberia, Asian Pacific. I had a dinner once with Supreme Court justice who had dealt with this case, O'Connor, and she asked, can you really tell that it's Asian? And I said, you know, if the Kennewick skeleton looked just like modern Native Americans, then there really would be a problem. Because my science is about, for this kind of problem, evolution. Everyone changes. And what would the earliest North American, Native Americans look like other than something, a morphology shared more broadly with Asia? Nothing. It's exactly what you would expect. But they weren't using that science, they used the racial science that took it out of time and space. finally, I guess it was a year ago, the Danes did DNA. Because now all throughout these court cases over this, my colleagues are mining data, mining data, mining data. And so now the DNA says that, oh, the DNA says more closely related to Native Americans than anyone else. Never needed that. It's a grab for control. Was it, maybe it was sapiens, but it was not my kind of sapiens. That's not what we do. We work with the community. In our lab, some of the earlier reports. Here you see on the left mortality. You can't get mortality data in any other way except for these Africans, because there's very little written about them anymore. We couldn't even find out, because we're interested in diet, we couldn't even find out what they were provisioned, what they ate on a regular basis. There's no European made a note of that. It was only John Gia, this African's narrative, that told us in detail that a little fat back and bread. Maybe if they were lucky once a month, they got a little meat. So that's the setting. But we were able to find high infant mortality that was 0 through 9. You put the first bar on top of the second one, then you have infant mortality. It's very high. You know, they say, my professor, George Omelagos, used to say, it was Alan Swedman, in fact, that's great doc, used to say, you can't kill a 10-year-old. And sure enough, at 11, they are 9. Because, they've gotten through the great early stressors of life. They are weaned. They've gotten through that. They're moving around. They haven't hit the adolescent and adulthood stressors. They're in that beauty spot. They don't end up in a cemetery. They're living to, at least be 12 to 13. So that gives us some sense that we've got good data. We were among the first to do mitochondrial DNA. Again, as I said, that's not terribly precise. I will just say that and other indicators of genetics like dental morphology basically tell us they're central, Midwest Central, and West Africa. It inspires these direct to consumer genetic services. I'm sure 23andMe is in some ways an offshoot of AfricanAncestry.com and others. And about this, I will say this. The one study that's actually done confirmed the relationship between the DNA findings and people of known ancestry. Bruce Jackson, Africans with a long knowledge of their sort of lineage, shows that they're wrong, most of the DNA is wrong. When I was at the Smithsonian making a presentation, there were three senior people interacting with, there's a big NIH and other folks, NIH and Smithsonian discussion of these services. And I was there, a geneticist, then a historian, sort of the senior people. And 23andMe showed an anecdotal example of somebody who perfectly showed us all, somebody who fit perfectly their expectations. I didn't want to talk too long because I had time to talk, but I just wanted to ask a question. This is an anecdotal example. I knew well enough that what about the other 25, 30, 100 people? Do they match this or not? I said, have you thought about using a sample of 30, which is a kind of good rule of thumb? Tested because no one at that point had ever tested the reliability of these studies, of these services. And they said, well, I don't know how we do that. which is an admission that it's not scientific. It may be DNA. You assume that means it's scientific. It's not scientific. You say, well, we might be able to use our models, which to me means it'll be circular at some point. So let me just waste, well, but I do want to say, however, there's an interesting book by Alondra Nelson at Columbia called The Social Life of DNA, which she discusses the political and social activity around DNA services and findings that people have. It does give people, as we hoped it would initially, but I had hoped we'd have that accurate approach to it, a more intimate relationship with African societies, more curiosity about the culture. So it is effective, whether it's scientific or not, in ways that are very interesting. Waste beads on this woman, give us some dental modification in 27 individuals. This was a practice that rarely was brought into the Americas, though we have one individual that has very slight filing, and it's kind of intermediate in terms of his chemistry. We think he was an American who had some memory of this African orientation. So we were also the first, I think, to do chemical sourcing. So these are the DNA data, DNA lead data. So you see down here the individuals who have modified teeth, who were, with rare exception, we have a lot of evidence that they would very likely be born in Africa, though we have exceptions, one exception at least, have very low lead levels. And the ones with very high lead levels tend to be children, so they were more likely born here when they died. So we have a kind of a lead, Iron Age, the lead age. European technologies relied a lot on solder, lead, pewter, these kinds of things that other technologies did not require. And so we know when they were born and raised within around that technology versus other technologies. And so we use that. Joseph Jones here at the College of William Mary is doing this kind of work for sourcing in terms of where people were born. Childhood stress based on these defects is intermediate, say. This was evidence of anemia. Again, sort of intermediate. In some ways, this population is better off than 19th century populations. In other ways, it's for example, fertility, natural increase, it really is more like a Caribbean population. They were not able to reproduce adults. This was a time when the slave trade was wide open, people were being traded in, and the quality of life was not important to slaveholders. Basically, people were being used up and replaced until 1807. Then when that, Virginia was particular, caused by the 1780s, somewhere around there. Virginia, early on, said, we want to stop the transatlantic slave trade. Because they found they were able to achieve some natural increase, growth in the slave population. And they wanted to command the domestic trade, which they largely did for a while. So it wasn't about sympathy to the enslaved. They wanted that market, they wanted to cut Africa off from it. This is evidence of syphilis on the individual on the right. We have one case of this kind of cloaca, these holes for the evacuation of pus, in the entire 419 individuals. There are individuals in the 18th century, Suriname, the population of 50, where half of them have this kind of evidence. So these are people who are just beginning to be exposed to syphilis. Where syphilis begins is uncertain. Some would say the Americas, perhaps, but there's something about what kind of goes on with European colonialism that changes it. And European colonialism is what transported syphilis around the world. So, you know, the French refer to syphilis as the Spanish disease, the British, it's the French disease. Africans called it the white man's disease. So it came to them very late, and we see that evidence here. They were involved, there's evidence that they were involved in smallpox inoculations. Very clear that at the turn of the 18th century, Africans and a recorded individual in Boston introduced smallpox inoculation to a population of people whose, you know, highest sort of medical practice was leeches. And they were afraid that perhaps these people, Africans, were trying to kill them by giving them smallpox, which is not an unreasonable suspicion. But ultimately they adopted it, and it was used throughout the colonial world. And, you know, Jenner later found and now I'll start with this and then just show you some quick slides of the monument. This is the latest work has to do with this muscle attachment called the linea aspera on the femur. All, you know, bone is living tissue. It's reacting in the living person to many things. And muscles are, many muscles are attached to the skeleton, and they're attached by, as you see, this ridge, and these kinds of attachments, these ridges. And the greater the work on a muscle experiences, the larger that attachment will become to anchor, stimulating osteoblastic activity, bone growth at the attachment. So the skeleton is adaptive, it's alive, its composition is completely replaced by every cycle that's about 8 years in duration. So we looked at 30 muscle attachments, including this one. We did a study here showing change in the frequency of enlarged muscle attachment. These are very enlarged in this woman. They can be much smaller. So we looked at the number of individuals with enlarged attachments. For men, at the beginning of the 18th century, about 75 or so percent of men had enlarged muscle attachments, and that extends all the way to the end of the 18th century. For women, they began with about 25% having enlarged muscle attachments. And the next phase, 40-some percent. And the next phase, 60-some percent. So by the time of the American Revolution, these African women had enlarged frequency of enlarged muscle attachments of the linea aspera involved in lifting and walking, many different things, equal to men. And we have put that within understanding of that in the narrative of changes that take place in the slave trade and in the attempts to control Africans. There were more men than women, more African men than women, very significantly. Just before the two revolts, 1712 and 1741. After which, the number of men drops and the number of women increases. We see that they are trying to control these revolts. They think the large number of men is part of the problem. And they begin to import more women and children directly from Africa. They don't have to pay as much for them. And then if they come from the Caribbean, they're seasoned, tortured, basically, that costs money. And the economy is changing in such a way that there's supporting more opportunities for domestic work, but there's also this other broad range of work. So it looks as though women are now taking the burden of work on their shoulders, their hips, their thighs, that was previously allotted to men in the course of controlling the slave trade, you know, controlling these people. If Leslie Rankin Hill likes to say, you know, they discovered that it's easier to control a black boy who's growing up than a full-grown man who was probably engaged in warfare anyway. That's how he was captured. All of this, so, and there you have it, origins, transformation, physical quality of life and resistance, in this case, all of these can be are related to the same story. And then I'll just finally, as we begin, open up for any questions you have. Funeral, one of the things we found archaeologically were kiln wasters from the two nearby pottery factories. Remains from the adjacent tannery. Whites were dumping on the African burial ground while these Africans used it carefully for the burial of their dead, putting a few little things they had to represent their care into these burials. There is the contestation of their humanity and their insistence upon it. The cemetery, you're thinking, was the first African institution in New York. They couldn't control their families, they couldn't create churches, they couldn't have schools, but they would have a cemetery, and this is where they would, had an opportunity to meet together. There's the reburial in New York, 2006. We could talk about the Sankofa symbol at some other point. Thank you very much.